Hey everyone. You know, if there's one thing I learned from watching the playoffs last year, it's that we should all be gambling a lot more. I'm just kidding. The main takeaway I took from watching the 2022 Stanley Cup playoffs is that the Oilers' window to win a Stanley Cup has finally opened. Now, I don't make this statement flippantly. In the 25 years that I've been an active Edmonton Oilers fan, the only time I stated out loud that I thought the Oilers could actually win the Stanley Cup was after Sean Horkoff scored late in Game 6 of the 2006 Stanley Cup Final. You heard that right. The only moment in the last quarter century that I felt comfortable enough to say that the Oilers could win the Stanley Cup was when they were literally 60 minutes away from doing it.
Did they do it?
Go clean your room, young lady.
Hey.
I don't know where I went wrong. But going into this season, I can comfortably say I believe they could win the Stanley Cup this year. That might sound pretty strange considering where the team was back in February, or even taking into account that they were swept by the Avalanche in the conference final. Well, let's take a look at what happened this past summer that has me feeling so optimistic. Ken Holland's first order of business was to renew head coach Jay Woodcroft for the next three seasons.
It's Woody!
You're kidding!
Woody!
This was probably the easiest decision of the summer after Woody turned the Oilers' floundering season around in February and took Edmonton to the Final Four for the first time in 16 years. Players spoke glowingly about Woodcroft's attention to detail and ability to communicate his message clearly and concisely. Fans were immediately won over by his podium power stance that exuded confidence and control. Heck, even fans of other teams were falling in love with this guy. In all seriousness though, there are a lot of things that Woodcroft does well, but there's one main thing that I feel distinguishes him from his predecessor, Dave Tippett. He stopped allowing teams to gain entry to the Oilers' zone uncontested. Tippett got away with this for the first 20 games of the season last year, but it blew up in his face in a big way come December. It's fine to play run-and-gun hockey if you have guys like Makar, Taves, Girard, and Byram on the back end, but not when you have skaters like Keith, CeCe, and Barry. This is no slight on these guys. They just aren't the fastest skaters. So it's the coach's responsibility to tailor a game plan to mask these deficiencies. Woodcroft, along with Dave Manson, immediately changed the Oilers' defensive strategy to one where the back-checking forward applied pressure to the puck carrier, and the defenseman would step up to angle the attacker towards the boards to prevent clean zone entries. The results were immediate and dramatic as the Oilers went from 25th in goals against per game to 6th. Now, the other big reason the Oilers salvaged their 2022 campaign was Evander Kane, who Holland re-signed for a very reasonable term and dollar amount. I will be the first to admit, I did not think Kane would have a positive impact on the team, never mind such an enormous one. The guy basically played at a 40-goal pace on McDavid's wing. He also brought some serious attitude along with his skill set, something the Oilers had been lacking in their top six for a few years now. My opinion of Kane as a human being has not changed one iota. I still believe he is a narcissist through and through. But there are a couple of reasons I think that he hasn't caused a big disruption in Edmonton. One is that, based on his social media posts, his situation at home seems to have stabilized. Now, believe me, I am fully aware that someone's online persona may not line up with the reality of their life, but based on appearances, things seem to have settled down a little bit. And really, whether he's just putting on a show for the public or he's actually made some changes in his life, as of right now, there's nothing to suggest he's getting into any trouble. And secondly, I've watched a lot of interviews with Kane. He's a pretty sharp guy. I am sure he is fully aware this is it for him. If there is even a hint of unsavory behavior on his part, his career will be over. And he has a lot at stake. He basically has the most enviable job of any winger in the league, playing shotgun with Connor McDavid. Time will tell on this one. The other notable addition to the team during the season last year, Brett Kulak, was also brought back on a rather team-friendly deal. Kulak really helped to stabilize the left side of the Oilers' defense corps, which was particularly noticeable in Game 6 of the opening round series, with Edmonton facing elimination and Darnell Nurse serving a suspension. Fun fact, this was the first time since the 2016 NHL trade deadline, when the Oilers brought in Patrick Maroon, that Edmonton acquired a player and actually retained them for the following season. Speaking of retaining players, you know which team is having trouble keeping guys around? Chirana. For the third consecutive summer, a Maple Leafs player reached unrestricted free agency and had a Lloyd Christmas epiphany.
What the hell are we doing here, Harry? We gotta get out of this town!
So, just like Zach Hyman the offseason before, and Tyson Barrie the year before that, Jack Campbell decided to come to the greener pastures of Edmonton, signing a 5-year, $25 million deal with the Oilers. Now, even though I rarely do videos anymore, I have made my thoughts on netminding abundantly clear over the last few seasons. Because it is such a volatile position year over year, I really don't think it's wise for teams to invest a lot of term in one. Which is why I'm not thrilled about the Campbell contract. This is a guy who has only played 135 games in the NHL, and he's only played more than 45 in a season once. Also, he's been injured 4 times in the last 2 years. So there is a fair amount of risk in this signing. Now, having said that, I do believe this is an upgrade over the tandem the Oilers have trotted out over the last 3 years. Mikko Koskinen, God bless his heart, was never going to live up to the bizarre contract old Pistol Pete signed him to just a couple of days before I got him fired with my black and white poster board sign in January of 2019. Koskinen had his share of brilliant performances, but he was clearly better suited to a lighter workload, as his game would go south pretty quick when he played too often. 3 years of watching Mike Smith play goal for the Oilers has probably shaved the equivalent amount of time off my life. Every time he went on one of his chaotic adventures outside the crease, I had to practice deep breathing exercises. This will not be missed. Now, here's the thing. The Oilers scored 65 goals in just 16 playoff games this past spring. In the series against Colorado, they scored 6 goals in one game and 5 goals in another, and they got swept. Similar to the Avalanche, I don't think the Oilers need a stud in goal in order to compete for the Cup. What I really think they need is someone reliable enough back there that isn't going to outright lose games for them. And I believe Campbell is more likely to provide that than the previous two guys. But, most important of all, the Oilers will be rolling out a liquid dish in goal every night this upcoming season. Soup or stew? Later on in the summer, the Oilers added Matthias Janmark. Nothing really stands out about this player at all. I think what happened here was Ken Holland was perusing the remaining free agents in mid-July. Then he cross-referenced his old guide and record book and he said, "Hey, I drafted this guy back in 2013 when I was with the Red Wings.
Pick him up!"
The next move he made did stand out to me though. Let's rewind the tape a decade to a time when I had a full head of hair, the hottest dance move was pretending to ride a galloping horse, and the Oilers were 3 years into a 10-year rebuild. Or a 15-year rebuild. Depends who you ask. Anyway, Edmonton had already drafted promising young forwards Jordan Eberle, Taylor Hall, and Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, but they were desperate for NHL-level defensemen to help the team progress. So, at the 2012 NHL Draft, where the Oilers once again had the first overall pick, anyone with an ounce of common sense knew they either needed to draft a defender or trade the pick for an established NHL defenseman.
Did they do it?
Did your sister put you up to this?
Okay.
Instead of doing the obvious thing, the Oilers took Yakupov first overall, and defenseman Ryan Murray went to the Columbus Blue Jackets with the next pick. Now, it's not as though Murray has had a stellar career. As a matter of fact, a number of high-quality D-men were taken shortly after, including Griffin Reinhardt, including Morgan Riley, Hampus Lindholm, and Matt Dumba. Murray's main issue throughout his career has been an inability to stay healthy. He's only played 82 games once in his 9-year career. When Murray has been in the lineup, he's actually been a fairly solid top four option. The closest comparable for Oilers fans would probably be a poor man's Eric Brewer, a defenseman picked quite high in the draft who wasn't particularly flashy, but got the job done well enough that the right people took notice and he wound up being selected to play for his country a few times throughout his professional career. But you know what? The biggest single reason I feel the Oilers are positioned to make a run at the Cup isn't about the additions they made this summer. It's actually about the subtractions.
Addition by subtraction.
What does that even mean? That is impossible.
It's very much possible, and here's how. In the 2022-23 season, the Oilers will not have Zach Cassian, Duncan Keith, and Mike Smith in their lineup. These three players accounted for almost $10 million against the salary cap last season. And you could make a legitimate argument that they would have been the three biggest liabilities on the roster this upcoming season. Now, I'm not saying that to disrespect these guys. They're professional athletes, and I appreciate everything they contributed to the team during their time in Edmonton. But since signing his pricey 4-year deal, Cassian has battled injuries and inconsistency. His deal wasn't an albatross, but his play probably warranted half that salary. Duncan Keith has had a wonderful career, and he provided excellent leadership to his D partner, Evan Bouchard, in the second half of the season. And you know what? Since Duncan Keith retired, I have really softened my stance on the trade that brought him to Edmonton. It's very clear now why the Blackhawks refused to retain salary, because they knew there was a realistic possibility that they were going to get hit with a rather large cap recapture penalty. And that's exactly what happened. But the thing about Keith is, and I think he was acutely aware of this, he has really lost a step. He got burned numerous times throughout the regular season and playoffs, most notably in overtime of Game 5 versus LA. And as for Smith, I give the guy all the credit in the world for battling through his injuries in the playoffs last year and the leadership he brought to the group. But at his age, just like Keith, the mind is willing, but the body is not able. So, what is so advantageous for the Oilers with these three no longer playing or taking up cap space is that the team's salary cap structure is finally more reflective of what each player contributes to the team. If you want to compete for the Cup year over year, your big money has to be tied up solely in your core guys. You can't be paying role players and over-the-hill veterans high percentages of the cap. The positions that were occupied by Cassian, Keith, and Smith are likely to be filled by inexpensive, quality players Dylan Holloway, Ryan Murray, and Stuart Skinner. I'm excited for this season, and honestly, I think you should be too. I'm looking forward to reading your feedback in the comments section, and I'll see you next time.